Whatever the mission, Collins Aerospace is there with adaptable, flexible technologies. We relentlessly tackle the toughest challenges our customers face. We protect the warfighter and help our military allies achieve overmatch in the connected battle space, breaking new ground with advancements in the next generation of aircraft, leading the industry in the development of secure open systems, all to make the modern warfighter safer, more connected, and more effective than ever.
Welcome back to our Air and Space Warfighters in Action series. And we're honored this morning to have Major General Alex Grynkewich. Alex, good morning. Can you hear me okay?
Loud and clear, sir. Thanks.
Okay. Well, as we get ready this morning to talk about the CENTCOM AOR, we couldn't be more honored to have the J3, the Director of Operations. And Alex brings an incredible depth and breadth of combat Air Force's experience, responsible for developing contingency plans and assisting with oversight of joint operations across CENTCOM's 20-nation area of responsibility in Central and Southwest Asia. Grynch brings, besides his background in combat Air Force's experience, a good deal of joint operations experience, including on the joint staff as the J-39. As always, I want to start with a thank you to our generous sponsors, Collins Aerospace, Elbit Systems of America, General Dynamics, Google Cloud, L3 Harris, Lockheed Martin, NextEra Energy, Oracle Cloud, the Pentagon Federal Credit Union, Pratt & Whitney, Raytheon Technologies, the Roosevelt Group, and SAIC. We cannot thank them all enough for helping us, the Air Force Association, spread the word about the incredible work of our nation's airmen and guardians. Well, Grynch, to start this morning, let's start at the highest level. As most of us know, President Biden recently approved the Global Posture Review, and the Pentagon has said further analysis is needed in addressing the Middle East. How did the results of this review impact the Central Command area of responsibility? And from the perspective of the J3, what kinds of changes might we see going forward?
Hey, sir, first let me just say thanks to you and the Air Force Association for having me here today. It's a real pleasure to do this, and I appreciate the opportunity to talk a little bit about what's going on in CENTCOM, and especially what our airmen and guardians are doing in the central region here today. So starting at that highest level, as you said, you know, the Global Posture Review did direct some further analysis and study on the overall level of forces in CENTCOM. As all of you know that are on the net, a lot has changed in CENTCOM just in the last year. And certainly even, you know, in times before that, things were already changing prior to the retrograde from Afghanistan. But change, I think the acknowledgement that more study is needed is important for a couple of reasons. The first is, you know, CENTCOM certainly recognizes that China is a pacing threat. It is what the entire national defense establishment is trying to focus on to understand how we can compete with China and perhaps prepare to prevail in conflict. I would say from the CENTCOM perspective, again, we understand that. We know that that is the pacing threat and we understand the importance of it. But America is a global power, and as a global power, America has to be able to deal with a number of different contingencies at a single period in time. Contingencies or crises could pop up in any number of areas of responsibility, not just U.S. CENTCOMs. So I think the things that you'll see change in the short term is a reduced force presence in CENTCOM. We're already seeing some of that with the retrograde from Afghanistan. We see that with respect to other forces that have been downsized as a result of that retrograde. For example, we used to have a couple of fighter squadrons in Afghanistan. Those are no longer there. And of course, the tankers and the ISR that supported all of those operations from an air perspective have also been repositioned. The other thing that I think you'll see is a more dynamic employment of global forces. In other words, rather than having a carrier strike group in US CENTCOM all the time, you'll see carrier strike groups come and go as the situation dictates and as events on the ground unfold, either to have an effect on the calculus of others or just as part of our enduring presence in the region and assuring our regional partners and allies. The last thing I'll say that I think is important from a CENTCOM perspective on the global posture review and then the Middle East work that'll go on after this is, you know, China is also certainly a regional power today, but aspiring to be a global power. And if you look at Chinese initiatives like the Belt and Road Initiative, which are trying to stitch their territory with that of Africa and Europe, and all of the work that they're, and all of the money that they're pouring in, all that money is pouring into one place, and that, well, not all of it, but a fair amount of it is pouring into one place, and that's the terrain that they have to go over in order to achieve their objectives for that Belt and Road Initiative and their longer term objectives to adjust the global order. And that is, it's gonna go through Central Asia up into Europe, and it's gonna go across the Middle East and the Gulf region into Africa. China cannot achieve their objectives without going through the US CENTCOM AOR. So as we look at what our posture is in the Middle East, we need to recognize that China is an aspiring global power. They're not just a regional problem. And think about what a sufficient force level is in CENTCOM. Again, it's gonna be nothing like it was in years past, with a couple of ground wars at their heights a decade ago or so, but it certainly is not zero. There are countries here that matter. The hydrocarbons in this region still matter. They matter a lot more to China than they do necessarily to ourselves. They matter a lot more to many of our regional partners and allies in the Indo-Pacific, including Japan. It certainly matters to our European partners. So CENTCOM's not going away, but we do recognize that there are going to be adjustments as we move forward.
Well, terrific around the world, really, perspective across international security demands, if you will, not just in CENTCOM, but certainly your combatant command counterparts. Could you talk just a bit, Grynch, about the growing demand for airmen and guardians, specific certainly to the CENTCOM AOR, but as you see convening commands and the ability of our airmen and guardians, our Department of the Air Force, Air and Space Forces to rapidly respond around the world and in your AOR, you can talk certainly a bit about over the horizon communications, over the horizon operations, I'm sorry, as well as now a relatively newly established space component in CENTCOM. So that ought to get you started. And again, thank you very much.
Yes, sir. Yeah. So, you know, the enduring characteristics of air power are what makes it so in demand around the globe. And certainly that speed, range, and flexibility is what allows US CENTCOM to execute many parts of our over the horizon counterterrorism mission. And that from an air perspective, if we look at operations in places where we are denied access on the ground. So today that would be Afghanistan, where by policy, we have withdrawn all US forces from Afghanistan. Or if we look at parts of Syria where we don't have a ground presence underneath, You have to have air power to get into those areas, and you have to have space power to look into those areas as well. And so what we have tried to do in US CENTCOM is stitch together as much of the capabilities as we can. And of course, we have some other capabilities, some residual networks that we're able to access, human networks, if you will. But we interleave those and layer on top of those an airborne layer of intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance, and of course, a space layer of intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance to try to build a picture of what's going on. So just from an over-the-horizon perspective, air power and space power could not be more important to getting that mission accomplished. I'd say more broadly, when you look at the U.S. CENTCOM AOR, despite the fact that we've had two major land wars ongoing here for a long time in CENTCOM, CENTCOM has always been an AOR, not entirely defined by the land, but in fact, more maritime and more air in terms of the characteristics that matter from a power projection perspective. So if you look at the challenges we face coming out of Iran, the Iranian problem is one that is, certainly when you think about the Iranian nuclear program or you think about Iranian malfeasance, the battle there is in the air. It's unmanned aerial systems that are coming after our troops. It's defending against those systems. And certainly any operations that you conduct in response to malign activity in CENTCOM, whether it's coming from Iran or whether it's Syrian chemical weapons or whatever it might happen to be, all of those operations depend on air and space power.
Could you also talk then, building on the demands for air and space power, cyber power? Certainly, Iran has proven to be formidable in their cyber hacking, cyber operations, and that brings in, of course, their own drone operations and ballistic missile operations. So could you just talk about Iran a bit, starting with their ongoing cyber operations?
Yes, sir. Sure. So I would say cyberspace undergirds almost everything that U.S. Central Command does. As with any major combatant command headquarters or any U.S. military headquarters, for that matter, at any echelon, the networks that we operate on are absolutely critical to executing mission command, command and control of our forces. And the adversaries know that. And the Iranians are actually pretty good in cyberspace. We see them conducting cyber attacks against regional partners. We see them contemplating cyber attacks against many others. And we also see them defending their own networks because they know the considerable cyber capabilities that both the United States has, as well as some of our key allies and partners, both in the region and from outside of it. And so when I think about Iran, they're a fairly difficult cyber target, but they certainly have their vulnerabilities. And so having a cyberspace capability, particularly one from an airman's perspective that can focus on elements of Iran that matter to airmen. In other words, integrated air and missile defense or ballistic missiles, those sorts of things, is really important. And it's also important when we think about Iran's more gray zone type activities or advanced conventional weapons transfers that they move from inside Iran across the Iran-Iraq border and all the way into Syria and toward Lebanese Hezbollah. Having a cyberspace capability, in many cases, you can conduct different kinds of operations that will give you insights into how those weapons transfers are ongoing. So there's a number of different ways that we try to keep track of all of the activities that our adversaries are doing. Cyber intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance is one of them. And of course, anytime we can hold targets at risk for, amongst any adversary using non-kinetic capabilities, that's a tool that we absolutely want to have in our toolkit.
Thanks. As aerospace industry commits every day to supporting broadly defined command and control requirements, JADC2, ABMS, certainly very important. Command and control, joint command and control for CENTCOM is the foundation for your business. That includes sharing information with your allies. So could you talk about just a bit the importance of being able to field joint command and control capability, JADC2 capability that includes the opportunity to integrate allies capability?
Yes, sir. I'm not sure I can limit myself just to a minute on the importance of joint C2. Maybe the way I'll answer this is I'll talk about the recent evacuation from Afghanistan, just for a moment or two, if you'll allow me. The when you look at the evacuation from Afghanistan, again, most of you are familiar with the broad contours of the operation that we pulled out, you know, 124,000 plus people from Afghanistan in a very short period. Of course, aware of some of the tactical things that happened, like the attack on Abbey Gate and the loss of our 13 Marines, the strike that we took on what we thought was ISIS-K, but wasn't. And those tend to get a lot of the attention as to whether the operation went well or didn't go well. In the background, for those of us who look at what are the key lessons that might apply from this non-combatant evacuation toward broader, higher-end military operations, if you will, command and control is at the forefront of my thinking here. And it's for a couple of reasons. The first is command and control at echelon. So our ability here at U.S. Central Command to know exactly what was going on the ground in Kabul was critically important. And the lack of a JADC2-like capability where we had a shared understanding of the data in terms of enemy force composition and disposition, our own force composition and disposition, exactly how many Afghan evacuees were on the airfield, aircraft schedules going in and out of HKIA from the airlift perspective, or just aircraft schedules as far as where is our ISR and our firepower overhead. That inability to have that kind of broad understanding of the environment shared at echelon from Kabul to here in Tampa, U.S. Central Command headquarters, and frankly, all the way up to the joint staff and higher in Washington, D.C., that took up an incredible amount of our own personal bandwidth here at CENTCOM as we tried to build that shared understanding using, frankly, archaic tools that we could have envisioned had we been sitting around in a command center in the 1990s. The second piece is it's not just at echelon, but when we look horizontally, the Afghanistan NEO was not a U.S. CENTCOM operation. U.S. CENTCOM was certainly the supported command, and we drove a lot of it, but it was a five combatant command operation. We were supported by U.S. SOCOM forces that have been provided to us for some of the in extremis things that might happen. Transcom was a huge player, bringing airlift into the theater and also conducting some of the intra-theater airlift in coordination with Air Force Central. You layer on top of that, EUCOM, European Command, which also provided intermediate staging bases and safe havens where we would move Afghan refugees once we'd gotten them to Qatar and pushed them up to Ramstein, let's say. And then of course, NORTHCOM, who is at the far end, collecting and catching all of those Afghan evacuees on the CONUS side of things. And so again, you needed a shared understanding across horizontally, those GCCs and functional combatant commands to try to gain a picture. And we just didn't have that from a joint C2 perspective. And we got there, but it was through brute force. It wasn't through agile employment of applications that can look at a common data lake and make sense of it. And then you mentioned General Wright, the other piece, which is allies and partners. The Afghanistan NEO was not a U.S. only operation. It was a coalition operation in the purest sense. I mean, we had aircraft from other countries coming in and picking up American evacuees or American sponsored evacuees. And we had our aircraft going in and picking up evacuees from other nations. And it was all one large combined operation. That to me speaks to the importance of having the ability to have that shared understanding and common operating picture across the entire coalition as well. So, you know, I've always thought ever since I worked on Air Superiority 2030 a few years ago, that C2 was really the backbone of what the Air Force was going to provide in future combat. And what I'd say is the Afghanistan NEO just reinforced that perception to me that if we can't figure out how to get that common operating picture for an operation that fundamentally should be more simple in terms of an evacuation, despite it being an incredibly complex evacuation, by gosh, I just can't imagine a high-end conflict on a scale that we might see in the future at the Straits of Taiwan or wherever else, and how we could be successful without that capability.
Well, I'll probably echo what a lot of your aerospace industry counterparts are thinking right now. How does aerospace industry get better insight into joint warfighting command and control requirements. Obviously, we have a JROC process. We have every service, Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, Guardians, all trying to build a common operational picture, if you will, the best possible command and control systems using, you know, the rapidly evolving modern IT capabilities that are out there. So could you talk a bit about how CENTCOM would invite or encourage industry to partner with you to have very updated command and control, in this case, command and control requirements more clearly defined so that there can be a better capability delivered more rapidly?
Yes, sir. So I think a couple of things. When I think about how do we need to retool our command and control capes here at U.S. CENTCOM, the thing that strikes me is it all begins with understanding our data and how we structure it and where we put it. And again, you know, we've been in the era of using a SharePoint portal or using a few different user populated web pages. And then email. So where industry can help us is understanding how we can structure our data, understand the data that we do have. We have massive amounts of it, but it's dirty, unstructured, disorganized. And that's kind of step one where we need help. And then I'd say from a perspective of what's the requirement and how do we shape that? I think we don't exactly know what the final product looks like. So look, you know, we've been experimenting in our Joint Operations Center here with a number of different applications. We've invested a fair amount of money into a couple of different applications that we want to try, and I won't go through them here, but we're trying different things because we don't know exactly what the solution looks like. So part of the issue is it's really, it's difficult for us to define a requirement and then wait a couple of years for something to be delivered from industry that would meet that requirement. So what we really need is we need the ability to work closely within industry in a rapid and iterative process to look at, once we get our data organized, once we understand what we have and how we want to display it and how it supports commanders' decisions, how can we rapidly adapt different applications based on the situation at hand? You know, what I need on a daily basis in terms of a common operating picture and a decision support tool for General McKenzie here is different than what I needed there in the NEO, and it would be different than if we were in some sort of an O-plan execution. And so to me, what we have to do is work really closer together than we have in the past, and rather than us just defining a requirement and then having industry build to standard, what we need is to iterate with industry, get the best ideas from industry on what's even available in terms of interpreting and accessing the data that we have. And then over the course of a couple of years now, as you all know, the pace of technological change, the different kinds of applications, different kinds of algorithms that will be available will change really rapidly. So from that sense, what I would be looking for is some sort of an open-ended partnership that we would have, probably within some sort of a contract vehicle, to rapidly innovate and integrate different tool sets as quickly as we could. The other thing that I think would hamper us is, you know, there's a host of different companies out there that have different ideas and different applications. What I'm looking for is a way to kind of bring those different applications together, to find ways to take different companies that have different widgets that might apply in an application. One might help me keep track of, let's say, the Blue Force disposition in Kabul. Another might help me keep track of number of Afghans on the ground. Another might do some predictive analysis on the stability in an environment. I need all of those different companies and U.S. Central Command, in this case, to be able to work together and integrate together. So having the flexibility from a contracting perspective where everything is, where companies are willing to work together and share different technologies, or at least share ways to bring them to bear comprehensively, as opposed to looking for a single solution, would be very helpful to us here.
Just outstanding. That sounds like a great JROC brief. Before we leave command and control, sir, could we talk a bit? You're connected at the highest levels of the intelligence community every day. What we know is, as the intelligence community demands for more advanced capabilities, including highly classified communication systems, and in fact, classified satellite capability, there's a lot of information out there in the IC. Could you talk a bit, or even provide recommendations on how the joint warfighting community, including the components and the services, might collaborate more effectively with the intelligence community. This sounds like a Senate Armed Services Committee and the Select Committee on Intelligence discussion, but your recommendations would, and your perspective, I think, would be helpful for all of us.
Now that's an important question and a tough one to answer. So you're exactly right. CENTCOM depends on highly classified intelligence capabilities, whether those are terrestrial and an airborne layer and a space layer, and we require the ability to fuse those together. We also require some very high-end classified capabilities just in order to maintain our own operations in U.S. Central Command. So I guess the first thing I'd say to my my friends and colleagues in the Space Force is, you know, U.S. Central Command can't get the mission done without them. And I neglected to mention it, General Wright, a few minutes ago, but CENTCOM is going to be at one of the first combatant commands to have a Space Force component. General McKenzie is very excited about that, and we think that'll be a big step forward. We also value our relationship with U.S. SPACECOM and are working through exactly how do the different elements of U.S. SPACECOM and our service component, soon-to-be service component from the Space Force, work together to deliver the most capability for U.S. Central Command. On the on how do we work together in these classified spaces, you know, the big challenge, and you alluded to my time as J-39 at the open, the big challenge we have is often compartmentalization, particularly of intelligence. And so the coin of the realm is trying to figure out how we can get to multi-layered understanding of multiple sources of intelligence, even though they come from different compartments. And those compartments might be because it's a classified platform providing it. It might be because it's a sensitive human source, whatever the reason that it's compartmented. We have to get to the point where we can have a holistic understanding of the picture that comes out of that. So there is a front end of where are we getting the information from, and then there's a back end for the operational user. So from the CENTCOM perspective, there are certain elements of the command that need to understand all the ins and outs of where we're getting the information from. But there's a large part of U.S. Central Command that doesn't really need to know, and frankly, probably is doesn't really care, if you will, where information is coming from, just that we have that information. And that would be the focus that I would have, is how do we build something where a broader set of our users can access the information that is from the highest classified sources that we have, but not need to know where they come from. And this, to me, so this isn't just a CENTCOM thing. I'll just close on this point. If you're going to talk about competition below the level of armed conflict, or what, call it gray zone warfare, hybrid warfare, whatever the label is you want to put on it, the highly classified, or the deep understanding that you can gain from highly classified sources as to adversary capability and intent is absolutely critical to competing in that space. So we need to not just figure this out for operations in CENTCOM, but really for operations against our highest threats and other AORs as well.
Well, just outstanding, Grynch. Terrific insight to joint and allied command and control requirements. Could we move a bit to your alliances across CENTCOM? Multiple. Countries that are hard to pronounce, like Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan, are certainly part of your big part of your portfolio, your alliance portfolio. And then there are complicated relationships like that with Pakistan, cooperative ally in some ways, and also has provided sanctuary for the enemies, if you will, over the years. So could you talk about your alliance relationships and probably bring in what I know is your strong, strong relationship with the Department of State, as General McKenzie and Secretary Blinken, in fact, work closely together across your AOR.
Yes, sir. So, especially in an AOR that is an economy of force theater, a rapidly becoming one, the partnerships that we have in the region and the partnerships, frankly, that we have with nations outside our region who contribute forces in the region. So the Australians from Indo-PACOM, for example, the Brits from UCOM, those allies and partners are absolutely key to U.S. Central Command getting our mission done. You know, when I think about the central region, and the countries in our AOR. You kind of hit on the Central Asian states, Pakistan up into the rest of the stands, the Kyrgyz Republic and whatnot. You know, those many of those partners are right next to the old Russian bear. We have to be cognizant of Russian interests in that region. They're adjacent to China, and there's certainly Chinese interests in those regions. So when we operate in the Central Asian region, we're cognizant that others have interests there as well, and that we don't want to put those countries in a position where they're forced to choose between one or the other, between America and the others in terms of partnerships. So we look for places where we can be value added, where we can help those countries with border security or other forms of security cooperation, maybe counter-narcotics work, and slowly build the relationships over time. And again, displace the more nefarious activity that might be coming from a Belt and Road Initiative that the Chinese have, which, you know, fundamentally ends up being something coercive in most cases. And so we think that we provide a solid alternative. America provides a solid alternative to some of those initiatives that might come from other actors less benevolent than we are. As we move from the Central Asian region to the Gulf region, look, we've got a whole host of great partners in the Gulf Cooperation Council countries, all up and down the Arabian Gulf. Many of those countries are very concerned about Iran, and we need to recognize that they're valid concerns that they have. If you move a little bit further, there's one other country that just entered the U.S. CENTCOM AOR, and that's Israel, another country that's very concerned about Iran. So in the era of the Abraham Accords, when we see the opportunity for greater cooperation between some of those GCC partners and some of the new members of the CENTCOM AOR, and between the traditional actors and allies that bring forces to the region, we're really looking to regionalize some of our approaches to the longstanding concerns that countries have had. So I mentioned Iran and unmanned aerial systems. We've seen since 2019 a number of unmanned aerial system attacks that have emanated in some cases from Iran itself and others from their proxies. And those are a threat to everyone. So there've been Iranian unmanned aerial system attacks against us as recently as the end of October at one of our garrisons in Syria. There are nearly daily attacks from Iranian-supplied unmanned aerial systems from the Houthi rebels in Yemen into Saudi Arabia. And there certainly are Iranian-supplied UASs that have been used to attack Israel. There's a common thread there, and there's now a common interest where if we can have a regional approach and work together from both those who live in the region and those of us like the United States, the United Kingdom, and others who operate in the region, when we can bring ourselves together, we can come up with a more comprehensive defensive profile against some of these threats. So that's the approach that CENTCOM tries to take. You know, General McKenzie is fond of saying, you know, we are an internationalist command. There is nothing we do in CENTCOM that we don't do without our allies and partners. They bring tremendous capabilities, sometimes some tremendous different aspects of authorities compared to what we have. And we certainly could not get our job done without them.
Okay. Just before we move to some of our media friends that are with us today, as well as others attending, and Amy McCullough, you'll be up next. But Grynkewich, before we go to Amy, could you just reiterate the international nature, the round the world implications for CENTCOM? For example, and this is probably a simple example, the flow of oil out of the Gulf to places like Japan as our ally is really important in maintaining stability in the region. So could you build off that view of the world, around the world a little bit, and how important it is for CENTCOM to work with the interagency, with the Department of State, really in many ways with the Department of the Treasury, to maintain stability in the region well short of combat operations?
Yeah, sir, you bet. So a couple of things. I'll start with oil since you started with it. You know, China gets roughly 50% of its hydrocarbons from the central region. So that means something. It means that the central region is important to China. And if it's important to China, it probably ought to be important to us as well. There are other allies around the world who are even more dependent on oil from the region than China. I think if I looked at the latest numbers from Japan sometime last week, it's about 80% of their oil imports come from the central region. Europe certainly gets a large portion of their oil inputs imports from the central region as well. So it remains a critical region just from a hydrocarbon perspective. Second thing, you mentioned working with the Department of State and others in the interagency. One of the key tools that we have here in this region is work that we do against narcotics. So it's a threat that knows no bounds globally. Whether they're poppies in Afghanistan or wherever the narcotic threat is coming from, it will flow through the central region, eventually back to the United States or maybe up into Europe. And that's a place where we can certainly cooperate. And we do have some really robust agreements with our regional partners that the State Department has helped us to put in place and that others in the counter-narcotics world in the interagency have helped us put in place. And then the last thing, we haven't talked about it, and it's amazing to me that we haven't mentioned too much about it in this session, but violent extremist organizations are still here and they're still quite real. And they still have the intent, if not the capability right now, to strike out at various homelands of the United States and other partners, whether that's ISIS attacks that continue in Iraq and Syria, whether that's ISIS-K trying to get its feet underneath it so that it can execute attacks at some point in the future, whether it's the remnants of Al-Qaeda down in Yemen or in Northwest Syria. So that violent extremist organizations continue to be a major factor. And we're very, very thankful that particularly in the de-ISIS fight, we are supported by a broad coalition of framework nations that meet regularly, both from a foreign minister and from a defense minister perspective. We also have a complementary NATO mission, Iraq, that is slowly expanding, doing ministerial level reform efforts with the government of Iraq. And again, all of that would not be possible without our State Department colleagues.
Great, thanks. Amy McCullough, you're up next, and then John Horner, General Horner.
Yes, thank you so much. Sir, you talked earlier about a shift to dynamic posture. And as the Afghanistan operations were drawing down, there also was a lot of talk of over the horizon operations, but not really a lot of details as to how this might be carried out. I'm wondering if you can elaborate on how this is working now, how it might be evolving in the future, and any updates on, potential new host nation agreements that are necessary to carry out these type of operations.
Hey, Amy, thanks for the question. The over the horizon counterterrorism, as General McKenzie has said publicly a few times, is difficult, and I would say it's very difficult, but it's not impossible. There's a couple reasons for it, and they're really simple. It's time and geography. So in order to conduct over the horizon counterterrorism in Afghanistan, we have to fly from a base at a location, wherever that happens to be, and project into Afghanistan. To even get to Afghanistan, it's a landlocked country. You've got to have agreements with regional partners to let you transit their airspace and go into Afghanistan. And then you have to know what you're looking for when you get there. So when we're not flying manned aircraft in Afghanistan and we're just flying unmanned aircraft, you all are very familiar with some of the broad capabilities of the MQ-9s that go into Afghanistan. And frankly, the United States and the United States Air Force have reduced the number of MQ-9s for all the right reasons, right? But they're investing in future platforms and trying to think about what are the ISR capabilities required for a more highly contested environment like in China. So all of those different factors now start to compress your ability to do over the horizon counterterrorism. So in general, here's kind of how it works. We fly MQ-9s, we fly them a long way, and we fly a limited number of them, and we try to keep track of the ISIS-K cells that have been highlighted to us by other all-source intelligence. And I won't go into a whole lot of detail as to where that other intelligence comes from, but you can think about it from a perspective of, layering different terrestrial and space-based intel cues, if you will, now with the higher-end sensors that we have on the MQ-9 that can zero in on a particular point on the ground. But we have limited coverage. So right now we're flying from a base in the Gulf region, and it's a long way. And you know, most of your flying time is transit time as opposed to collection time. So it would be nice to have somewhere that we could operate closer to Afghanistan from. Those are very delicate negotiations. What we don't want to do is, again, force a country to make a decision between supporting some ask that we give and maybe having to worry about their Russian neighbor to the north. And so we're proceeding at a very deliberate pace with those negotiations. We do recognize, and this is, you know, very much supported by the Department of State, we do recognize that there's a strong desire on our part operationally to get closer, and of course strategically a desire to build some of those relationships into more robust relationships with some of the Central Asian states, but it's going to take some time in order to get there. So where that leaves us, and you know, for the industry folks that are on here, what I would tell you is, you know, the fact of the matter for US CENTCOM is there's really nothing else that has the collection capabilities and the unique combination of collection capabilities that the MQ-9 has right now. So I'm a capabilities, you know, kind of guy. I don't want to ask for MQ-9s. I want to ask for something that can provide full motion video and SIGINT and whatever INTs it is that you're looking for. But when you start adding those all up, there really is nothing else. I think we'll find other environments in the future where we need a persistent collection capability, and whether that comes from a space-based collection capability, whether there's some sort of near space collection capability, or other kind of long-range loitering airborne layer capabilities that we can find, those are going to be critically important, because I guarantee you there will be other environments like this that we see in Afghanistan.
Thank you, sir. And if I could follow up real quickly, you also mentioned earlier the lack of JADC2 capability and its impact on the NEO operations. Given the reliance on intelligence and data and MQ-9 operations, how is that lack of JADC2 capability impacting over the horizon operations?
Yeah, I would say right now, not too much, just because the pace of the operations is manageable. Where I find it becomes extremely critical to have that JADC2 capability is as the tempo of operations increase. I can envision times when over the horizon operations would reach that tempo, but it's the tempo that really gets us where we don't have time as humans to look at the data ourselves, and we need the machines to do it for us and make sense of it. I guess that's my best answer for you. Having said that, If you did have JADC2 and you had these different layers of intelligence collection, I certainly see the benefit in how that would bring things together and stitch it together. And you probably would be able to derive much more meaning from a much more extensive data set than humans have the ability to go to and digest. And you know, the way we solved it in the NEO, by the way, is we just threw manpower at the problem. If we couldn't, we didn't have the IT tools, the applications in place, the JADC2 applications in place to make sense of the data. It just became very manpower intensive to execute that.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks, sir. Go to John Horner next, and then Rachel Cohen and Tony Rock in that order, if we could.
Hey, Grynch. Thanks for the candid remarks. It's John Horner. How do you read?
Loud and clear.
Great. You mentioned the threat that Iran poses in the region. Obviously, we need to project power to include the ISR you mentioned as a backdrop. Of course, we've got Russia and Belarus and China and North Korea, et cetera. So one of the things, as you mentioned, is we've got to empower our key partners and allies in the region. Saw the recent announcement about the UAE seeking some providers other than the U.S. How do you see the tea leaves for us to keep from getting outmaneuvered in the bureaucratic hurdles of getting capable platforms and weapon systems into the theater? And in particular, which of the key allies or our partners in the region do you see us working with?
Yeah, you know, I think the way I'd answer this is there's the partners in the region who want to buy U.S. Capabilities do so for a couple of reasons. The first is they really do think that our kit is the best, and frankly, it still is the best kit in the world. The Chinese industrial base does not produce nearly the quality of capabilities that the U.S. industrial base does. The Russians have a few niche things that they provide, but frankly, again, U.S. capabilities are much more valued just because they are more capable than what our global adversaries or competitors can provide. The second thing that is almost more important is our allies and partners are really buying our stuff because they're buying the security relationship that they have with us. And that to me is why they're really willing to put up the combination of those two things, the capability that we provide and the relationship that comes with buying US capability. That is why they're willing to put up with an FMS system that has a lot of steps to go through in order to buy something that takes a fair amount of time. You know, I think many of our allies and partners get frustrated with the pace of FMS sales. They want things delivered faster and quicker. Russia and China can deliver faster and quicker, but again, they can't deliver the security relationship and they can't deliver the capabilities that we can. But that's a place where I think as an enterprise, we could certainly try to improve. And this is a whole of government kind of thing, where if we could improve the pace and responsiveness of our FMS sales, I think that would make a meaningful impact as we compete not just in the central region but globally with China and Russia, and basically keep folks in our camp and not push them to go somewhere else. Particularly acute here, where they are so worried about Iran on a daily basis, where the Saudis are getting shot every single day. They need capability, they need it fast, they need it operationally responsive. And the more we can do to make our system reflect their requirements while still adhering to all of the very valid restrictions that we put on end-use monitoring and whatnot, all of that is got to be brought together, I guess. I think the second part of your question was which allies and partners in the region matter. I tell you, I was amazed at the performance of some of our allies and partners just in the Afghanistan NEO. The responsiveness from the Qataris in particular, I mean, talk about knowing who your friend is. They took incredible risk with the number of Afghans that we brought in. They took incredible risk and are still taking incredible risk trying to keep the airport in Kabul open so evacuees can continue to flow out. They have just proven themselves to be magnificent partners. The Saudis we work with every single day, they again are facing a very real threat that manifests. You know, even this weekend there were, you know, several one-way lethal UAS attacks against Saudi Arabia that they're defending against, so I'm very aware of their perspective and the criticality of that relationship. UAE is a signer of the Abraham Accords, Bahrain, those two countries. Clearly some opportunities there for deeper cooperation. Kuwait has been a longtime host of our forces in the region. As we work, you know, further up into the Levant area, Iraq, I mean, that is a really important partnership. You know, some people, and I'm one of them having spent a year on the ground there, would say, I think Iran really wants to get their fingers into Iraq, wants to control it. And because of that, I view Iraq as key terrain. You know, all of the different parties come together there, Sunni versus Shia, and various elements of secularism versus nationalism versus Iranian alignment within the Iraqi body politic. That's key competitive space for us if we're going to displace Iranian influence in the region writ large and prevent Iran from being able to project across a Shia crescent over to Lebanese Hezbollah and threaten Israel. So Jordan, Israel, Egypt, you know, still a cornerstone of Arab-Israeli cooperation and the relationship between those three countries, very important. And again, we're looking for ways that we can expand that cooperation against common adversaries like Iran.
Great answer, thanks. And I also look forward to you guys maturing that space component initiative and getting interoperability in that realm as they seek capability in space over.
Thanks, John and Rachel Cohen, and then Tony Rock and Brian Eberstein is also up. So, Rachel, go ahead, please.
Hi, everybody. Thanks for doing this. Rachel Cohen with Air Force Times. Given the situation, you know, in the region, you know, obviously things are changing, but, you know, as you mentioned, there's plenty that's staying the same in terms of violent extremism and you know, the Iran, you know, a lot of things that haven't really changed. I'm curious what you think the outlook is for our installations like Al Udeid, Ali al-Salam, you know, the places where we have traditionally kind of consolidated forces as a way to project elsewhere in the area. Do you anticipate that those are going to require, you know, maybe fewer people stationed there, more people stationed there, you know, different capabilities there? You know, and are you talking to the host countries about that? I'm curious what the outlook is for them.
Yeah, you bet, Rachel. Thanks for the question. So, you know, as the footprint of air power changes in the central region, and many of those bases that you mentioned have other things besides air power there as well. So as the overall footprint changes in the central region, I think it's natural to look at what our base operating footprint is at each of those locations, and even to revalidate what's the value of a particular installation. You know, the key value of many of those places that you talked about, Ali al-Salam, Al Udeid, Al Dafra, and even Prince Sultan Air Base, and others, is the relationship that it becomes a place from which you can project a relationship with the host nation. It's very meaningful to those host nations that we have a presence there. They view it as important to their own security that the Americans are there with them. And so it is critical. That doesn't mean that the installations are going to stay static. Certainly the number of airmen at those locations, the number of guardians and others at those locations will change as our footprint changes. I would say that the other thing that we think about often, particularly in the wake of the missile attack on Al Asad back in 2020, is that bases in the region, just like bases in the Pacific, if you think about the first, second island chain kind of concept, you could almost describe some of those bases along the Gulf as kind of the first island chain equivalent. You just flip the map over east versus west, and there is a concern about the vulnerability of those locations to Iranian ballistic missiles in the event of a broader conflict. I think those nations are very aware of that, threat. It's not just a threat to our airmen that are there, if you will. It's a threat to the capital cities of many of those countries. And so they're very keen to think about what it means to them. The host nations are very keen to think about what it means to them from a defensive perspective to have U.S. capabilities there. And then, of course, we are very keen to think from a U.S. CENTCOM perspective about what does that mean operationally for the execution of contingency plans, et cetera, and how do we mitigate that risk either through defensive measures, through repositioning, and whatnot. So, again, I think we're always going to be reevaluating exactly what the footprint is and do we have the bases where we want them to be. I think given the importance that those bases have to the relationship, any decision to shutter a base or something like that would certainly be made at a higher level than U.S. Central Command just because of the implications on the relationships that it would have. And again, we get a lot out of each of those locations as well. They're key C2 nodes. They are platforms for Inherent Resolve, the de-ISIS fight. And you know, it's hard for me to see one of them that's more important or less important than the other right now.
Thanks, Grynch. And let's go then to Tony Rock, and then we'll be close to wrapping up, I think. Tony, please.
Thank you very much, sir. And Grynch, I appreciate everything you and your teammates are doing there. I'd like to bring you back to the geographic margins, if not the strategic margins, of your AOR, and that's Pakistan. Having spent 22 months there as the chief of ODRP and having left there in, I guess, 2016, it took me a while, but I finally figured out that the only thing the Pakistanis perhaps fear more than often irrational fear of the Indians is their fear of irrelevancy with regard to the West and specifically the U.S. It often causes them to turn towards China, whether it's buying new airplanes or any number of other transportation line of communication initiatives like the new road. So if you look back over 75 years of relationship with Pakistan as a nation, you can very clearly see at least three huge sign and cosine shifts for the U.S.-Pakistani relationship. And I wonder if we're on the edge of another one. The Pakistanis are quick to tell us that when it's cold outside, Pakistan is the warm mittens that America puts on. And when it warms up, you toss us aside and don't come looking for us again until it turns cold again. But is what kind of efforts, without going into classified details, what kind of efforts are we taking to try to keep the Pakistanis in a better place than where our relationships in the past 75 years have shifted and it's gotten really, really cold with them?
Yes, sir. Thanks for the question. You know, the when we, you called it the geographic margins of the AOR when you introduced here, I would tell you that we certainly recognize here at CENTCOM that Pakistan is an extremely important country. And if you think about the implications of if things go wrong between Pakistan and India or some other contingency were to befall Pakistan, whether it's a humanitarian emergency or whatever, the fact that it's a nuclear armed country, given the size of the country, given its importance in the region, given the pride of its people, it is an absolutely critical country in the CENTCOM region. And if we're not going to pay attention to it, we do so at our own peril. So we do put a lot of value on the relationship with Pakistan. General McKenzie has a terrific relationship with General Bajwa. I guess I'd go back to during the Afghanistan NEO, there was a point in time where on very short notice, based on some decisions at the highest political level as to exactly how the timing was going to happen for the retrograde of military forces from Afghanistan, we ended up having to ask the Pakistanis, you know, maybe I think it was 24 or 48 hours out, if we could move a rescue capability to one of their bases. And they immediately, without hesitation, said yes. So again, I think that speaks to the strength of at least the mill-to-mill relationship with Pakistan. And Pakistan is a big country. It's an important country. It's a complex country. But from a mill-to-mill perspective, we do put a lot of effort into engaging with the Pakistanis. We've obviously talked to them a lot lately about over the rise in counterterrorism. Being able to fly through Pakistani airspace is absolutely critical to meeting our objectives in Afghanistan with over the rise in counterterrorism. Those negotiations and those discussions are something that continue. But so far, the Pakistanis have just been incredible partners, both during the evacuation and since. And like I said, I think from CENTCOM's perspective, we want to keep it that way. We want to keep dialoguing with them, keep addressing their concerns and look at things from their perspective and make sure that we keep them as close as we possibly can to us.
Well, thanks again, sir. As we wrap up, please, from your Air Force Association, our sincere thanks to General McKenzie and the CENTCOM team, your soldiers, your sailors, your airmen, your guardians, your Coast Guardsmen, your interagency partners, certainly in the intelligence community. Your Air Force Association is on your wing. At the same time, we are the Air Force Association, and this is about air and space warfighters in action. As we wrap up here, could you talk a bit about those capabilities that really are required across the spectrum of joint combat operations, from a high-end fight, a ballistic missile defense, or offense, if you will, best defense is a good offense, continue to certainly deter the dangers of violent extremism around the world. What are those air and space warfighter capabilities that come to mind first? If you would leave just a few minutes to wrap up, please.
Yeah, you bet. So, when I think about stitching together an operation, whether it's against a violent extremist organization or whether it's some broader contingency operation, several of the joint functions come immediately to mind. One is intelligence. And so the capability that air and space forces bring from an intel collection standpoint is absolutely, as I've alluded to here, absolutely essential to meeting our over the rise in counterterrorism objectives. It's also absolutely critical to being able to meet broader targeting objectives, either for contingencies or crises that might evolve. We could not do the things that we do in CENTCOM or that we need to be prepared to do in CENTCOM without that intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance capability that the Air Force and the Space Force provide. Second, the command and control, and we've hit on that a few different times, but there beyond JADC2, the ability for the Air Force, either through ground-based command and control capabilities like a CRC or airborne command and control capabilities like an AWACS. Those are really key to CENTCOM operations. We have a lot of complex ops that go on both in Iraq and Syria and more broadly across the Arabian Gulf region. The ability to command and control those at the operational level is one of the things that airmen can do that really no one else brings to the fight in the same way that we do. There's operational level command and control in other services and other service components besides how the Air Force does it, but the synchronization of joint effects that the Air Force is able to do and the command and control capability we provide is really essential. And then the last thing is the effects. A lot of the times in the CENTCOM AOR, those are kinetic effects that we talk about. So having, you know, bomber task force missions come into town, having fighter capabilities that flow in and out of the AOR as the situation requires, those are still critical capabilities in U.S. Central Command. Very important to what we do, very important to deterring Iran, very important to removing threats to our forces that are on the ground or in the air. But there are other effects as well. You know, U.S. CENTCOM is the most highly, we have within Iraq and Syria, I would argue, the most highly contested electromagnetic spectrum anywhere in the world, And so having electronic warfare capabilities show up that the Air Force often provides, the Navy provides some, but the Air Force provides others, is really essential. And that can be key to defeating unmanned aerial systems. It can be key to contesting adversary command and control. Those are kind of the key capabilities that come to mind. And, you know, I couldn't be prouder to be part of U.S. CENTCOM, and I couldn't be prouder of not just the airmen and guardians, but really all of the joint force that we've got working together in the AOR.
Thanks, sir. Your leadership today for all of us and certainly your such clear articulation of the requirements, the joint warfighting requirements of CENTCOM have not just been educational, but certainly what you described should motivate your aerospace industry counterparts and certainly your Air Force Association. In closing, it's the holidays. On behalf of General McKenzie, you and General McKenzie, do you have words you might share for all those airmen and guardian soldiers, sailors, Marines, and Coast Guardsmen who have served over the years in the CENTCOM AOR and are serving there today?
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity to say something on that. You know, the first is, you know, there will be a lot of folks in U.S. CENTCOM who are not home for Christmas this year, not home for the holidays this year, won't be home for New Year's. What I would tell them is what they are doing is absolutely essential to U.S. national security. It's essential to making sure that VEOs don't rise up and strike us. It's essential to dissuading Iran from getting a nuclear weapon and conducting other malign activity in the AOR. And it's essential, frankly, to displacing Russia and China, the two global competitors, from meeting their objectives in the CENTCOM AOR. So that'd be the first thing I'd say is what our forces are doing is important. And, you know, for those who haven't been in the CENTCOM AOR in a long time, what those soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, guardians are doing is not what you and I would have done in the CENTCOM AOR a decade ago. We're not flying in circles waiting for someone to call for a weapon and drop it and then going home and watching our readiness degrade. We're practicing for the high-end fight on a daily basis in CENTCOM, and that high-end fight in many cases is upon us, you know, almost on a daily basis with UAS attacks, et cetera. So again, I think what I tell them first is it's important. For those who've served in CENTCOM in the past, I tell you a couple of things. You know, Afghanistan is a raw emotional event for many people. You should be very proud of what your joint force was able to accomplish in the Afghanistan retrograde operationally. Forces performed magnificently. There were, as I mentioned, a couple of tragic events that happened, and we lost 13 Marines and a couple of others as a result of those events. And others, innocents, lost their lives as a result of those events. But at the operational level, the performance of the joint force could not have been better. So I would say we all ought to be proud of both that fact and of all the things that we were able to accomplish in Afghanistan over the years, as much as it might have ended in a manner that none of us would have liked to have seen play out in real time. And then on a more hopeful note, I would tell you that in Iraq and Syria, I see a lot of reason for hope. I see ISIS still on the ropes. I see the potential for some real progress in Iraq. There's plenty of risk there. Things could certainly go wrong. There's people who want to make them go wrong, particularly in Tehran. But there's a lot of reasons for hope. And we should all be proud of the trajectory that that's on.
Well, General Grynkewich, thank you. And Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays again to the CENTCOM team, every soldier, sailor, airman, marine, guardian and Coast Guardsman there. And again, our thanks to General McKenzie for letting his J3, who works about 24/7, spend some time with your Air Force Association today. God bless. And thanks again, Grynch.
All right. Thank you, sir. And thanks, everybody. I really enjoyed the conversation.